Chip Robinson, driving the Jaguar at the time of that crash, is Hurley Haywood's co-driver today. The car protected him. They lost the car, but they have Robinson. And, of course, that's what's most important.
Very, very important. It's really a tribute to the strength of these cars. Look at this battle that we've got here. This is spectacular racing right now. We've got Price Cobb and the Dyson Porsche, the winner of Riverside, followed very closely by that ultra-high horsepower Nissan. There's John Paul sitting back there, and I think Pete Halter is actually closing up in the second row. We've got a fantastic four-car battle. Whoa. Look at this, all together.
Oh! That's Pete Halsmer in the Ford Probe nearly running up the tailpipe of John Paul Jr. in the Buick, having trouble getting around the number 9 car. That's the Camel Lights machine of Deborah Gregg and Jeff Klein.
Awfully close. Pete could very easily have damaged the front end of his car at this point. Fortunately, it was at a good place in the track where even though he had to get off the gas and onto the brakes a lot harder than he wanted to, the loss of the boost doesn't hurt him too much because we're in a downhill section where you really can't use too much horsepower. Now everything's equal. It looks like Johnny's going to take a run at the... No, you can't. Look at that horsepower. Incredible power by the Nissan, able to pull ahead, even when John Paul had a bit of a run at him from the hairpin.
To give you an idea of what we're talking about, the Buick team, the Conti Racing team, says that Buick can turn some 900 horsepower with full turbocharging. Lots of racing to come here at Laguna Seca. Klaus Ludwig in the Ford Probe is your leader. Back. Ron Kendrick is on pit road for round 3 of our ESPN coverage of IMSA Camel GT Racing in 1986. And there is your leader in the Monterey Triple Crown Grand Prix, Klaus Ludwig in the Ford Probe.
Well, Klaus hasn't even put a wheel wrong at this point, other than that very slight scrape on the side of his car. Like, this thing is absolutely perfect, and it appears to be perfectly suited for the track. It's very, very nimble, and it uses the horsepower that it does have available, which, as I've mentioned, is maybe 700 at maximum, so he's giving away an incredible amount of horsepower, but leading the race very handily.
Now coming into view, Hurley Haywood in the Jaguar, putting up a surprisingly good effort here. Now, the Jaguar has been hampered a little bit by the fact that it's a normally aspirated 12-cylinder car. It doesn't have the turbocharged power of virtually all of its competitors in the GTP class. But the Jaguar is showing very, very well today.
Well, on a track like this, the engine's characteristics, that's a very wide torque band, and it's a very smooth motor to drive with, really offsets that additional horsepower that a turbocharger can give you. Hurley can apply the power when he wants to. You don't have to anticipate a point in the track when you want full power that a turbocharged driver would have to do. When you come into this hairpin corner with a turbo car, you have to get on the gas actually before you want full power, but it takes a second or two for that motor to catch up.
And following into that turn, third place and fourth place, this is Price Cobb dicing with Elliott Forbes Robinson in the Nissan, and you see the streams of rubber that Elliott Forbes Robinson is leaving.
Look at this. Just unbelievable horsepower that car is putting out.
Elliott Forbes Robinson out of Denver, North Carolina, just blows by Texan Price Cobb in a Porsche 962.
The more I watch this car, the more impressed I am by the horsepower, because these cars generally, when you're accelerating from 0 up to 130, the rate of acceleration is very, very similar, and for that car to do what it did is just almost unthinkable. Really an impressive display for that motor.
And Elliott Forbes Robinson continues to just pull away from Price Cobb, being followed at this point by the Buick. I believe that's the 45 car of John Paul Jr. down through the corkscrew. Perhaps the most recognizable turn in motorsports. A three-story drop through these sharp left-right-left turns.
Look at that black smoke still pouring out. But again, like, this isn't a sign of anything wrong with that engine. I'm sure this is by design, and they're doing it running the engine deliberately rich to make sure that it's going to live, that it'll be cool enough to withstand the rigors of this pace. Obviously, the horsepower isn't suffering. Usually, you try and run a motor a little bit in the lean side to get as much possible horsepower. It's obviously not necessary for Nissan. They have an abundance.
Price Cobb running with lights on so that traffic can see him easily in its mirrors as he picks them up. But right now, his problem is in his own mirrors. John Paul Jr. in a Buick all over Price Cobb as they pass one of the Camel Lights cars.
Yeah, John has really closed up here in Price. I'm sure he's going to try and take a run at him as soon as he possibly can. He's driving somewhat conservatively at this point. I think they have set the Buick engine with a lower boost to try and get this car to live for the duration of the race. Normally, the Buick would close up on the Porsche and acceleration coming out of the hairpin. You can see John is making up his ground entering the corner. That is under braking and the application of power as he comes out. He's closing right up on Price at this point.
This is a sprint race. Now, the IMSA Camel GT stars run distances from 3 to 6 hours, even 12 and 24-hour races. This one, a mere 98 laps of this 1.9-mile Laguna Seca course, will take less than 2 hours, and it's very much a sprint. Fuel is not a problem in a race like this.
No, they can run a higher boost than they normally would, and John again is posed right up on the back of Price's car. I wouldn't be at all surprised to see him take a run out of this lap. He's definitely in possession. He's only got one slower car in the way, and they should be able to get by going through the S's here.
Traffic becoming a factor as the field begins its lapping. So that's a Camel Lights car. Price Cobb swinging back and forth across the track, trying to get around the slower traffic.
This tends to be a bit of a problem. Turns 1, 2, and 3 at the Laguna track are extremely high speed. They're all fifth-gear corners, and dropping into fourth-gear going up the hill here, so it's a very fast section. Look how fast these fellas are going. They're actually coming up to lap the GTP Light leading car. Bob Earl is the number 24 right in the front of the picture there, is the leader of GTP Light, and yet these cars have caught, and Klaus Ludwig, our leader, has actually passed him. He's a lap down already.
Now we're back up on the point. Klaus Ludwig really having things his way. Now that's Al Holbert in front of him. Holbert, who started on the outside front row, is trying desperately to keep from being lapped by Ludwig, at which point he would go two laps down to the field. Ludwig at this point passing Bruce Levin's number 86 car, putting him another lap down. Al Holbert, who you see there in the front of your picture in the number 14 Porsche, does not want to get caught by Klaus Ludwig one more time.
Well, Klaus would love to put Al an extra lap down. It would just give him that much of a cushion. Holbert is so feared by competitors that even though he does have a one-lap lead at this point, like Klaus has a one-lap lead, he's not comfortable. He wants to put Al 2 down because you can't count the Holbert Racing Team out. They are so good. They have come back in this situation so many times and come back to win races that you have to try and take every advantage you get. And to lap them one more time would be a tremendous advantage for Klaus.
Back once more under the start-finish bridge through turn one and into turn two. Al Holbert being chased by Klaus Ludwig. Holbert is one of the faster Porsche cars on the circuit. Al won 9 races in 1985. He already has one victory, that in the Daytona 24 Hours this year. Yet.
Here's Johnny trying a pass now in Price. And look, yes, this time he made it cleanly. He must have got on the gas just that little bit earlier coming out of the hairpin and was just enough to offset that Porsche advantage.
John Paul Jr. in the Buick taking over fourth place from Price Cobb into Porsche. And we'll be back for more racing from Laguna Seca Raceway. Klaus Ludwig in the Probe leads, followed by the Jaguar and the Nissan. We'll be right back. Laguna Seca, California, and the Nissan Monterey Triple Crown Grand Prix for Camel GT prototype cars. There is your leader, Klaus Ludwig, in the slightly damaged Ford Probe number 7, being tracked by the number 44 Jaguar. At the top of your picture there, that's Hurley Haywood in the Jaguar XJR 7. And here's the sister car. Excuse me, Bill, go ahead.
I was going to say, it appears the damage that was caused to that car at the start of the race really hasn't created any major problems for Klaus. Here's a great in-car shot going up towards the corkscrew. Camera work here. And there's the sister car, the 07 car, just snuck through there as we were watching. That's Pete Halsmer in that car. In fact, Pete last year drove for the car that you just saw the pictures taken from. He was a BF Goodrich team driver with the Jim Busby team. Moving on to Ford this year, I'm sure he just gave an extra little smile when he passed that car.
Interesting story behind this car. The original number 2 car for the Pro Team was destroyed in a devastating accident at Riverside, California just a week ago. They thought they would come to this race with just one car as we watch Bob Earl, the Camel Lights leader, and the Pontiac Fiero. But they were able to get the number 2 car into condition for this race, and Pete Halsmer is doing very well. Speaking of doing very well, this man, Bob Earl, leading Camel Lights, only the third race for this prototype car. There goes Al Holbert. Gives you a good idea of how much faster the full-scale, if you will, prototype cars are than the Camel Lights cars. But the Camel Lights guys do get a pretty good competition going among themselves.
They've got an excellent series this year, and it's just getting better and better with the inclusion of cars such as this. These cars actually will corner every bit as quickly as a full GT prototype car, and really the only difference is when you're exiting a corner. When the GTP cars come up to lap these cars, they lose no time at all following them through the corners, and in some cases, the smaller the GTP light cars will actually corner a little bit faster.
We saw that going through the corkscrews there. Bob Earl, who also campaigns a GTU car, able to keep pace with this man, Al Holbert, out of Warrington, Pennsylvania, last year's Camel GT Series champion with 9 victories, tying a record. But this just not in the cards for Al Holbert, who is 2 laps down at this point, to this man, Klaus Ludwig, going through the slowest turn on the course, turn 9, sliding a little bit through the turn, and making his way to the start-finish line.
Well, Klaus is certainly putting on a performance to be remembered today. He is driving beautifully, and I again, using this much smaller engine car than anyone else in the race has, using it to its maximum potential and taking advantage of that outstanding handling, brilliant braking. Look at him close up here in the smaller GTP light car going through the S's. Very fast section of track down from here, 150, 160 miles an hour. Even this area here, you're still doing 130 for entering this uphill section.
Once again, Bob Earl, who does double duty on the Camel GT circuit. He also drives a GTU Pontiac Fiero that looks much like the ones you see on the street.
It's such a good-looking car. That really is a very pretty car.
A similar car running the European sports car circuit. Another good look from inside our BFG Porsche. This is a Busby Racing Porsche. Jim Busby, who puts together the BF Goodrich team. We took a closer look at the man behind the BF Goodrich Busby Racing operation. Let's take a look at that man. Down the coast from Monterey in Laguna Beach, California, are the shops of Jim Busby Industries, home of Busby Racing. Those shops are busy these days as the 43-year-old Busby and his team prepare for their most ambitious effort yet. In addition to a total rebuilding of the team's BF Goodrich-sponsored Porsche 962 for the IMSA Camel GT circuit, Busby's crew is preparing a totally new car for next month's 24 Hours of Le Mans. A husband and father, racing has been Jim Busby's career since his first visit to a racetrack as a boy. The trip has taken him to some of the world's most prestigious road racing circuits. Along the way, Busby has raced virtually every kind of sports car. Still, after more than 10 years on the Camel GT circuit, this dyed-in-the-wool road racer remembers the drag strips of his boyhood.
My career in motor racing started basically because I was fascinated by cars. My dad took me out to the Times Grand Prix in 1958, and I sat in turn six and I watched Chuck Day and a Scarab win the race. And I thought that was pretty much out of my reach financially, and I didn't really have anybody to help me in that direction. Whereas in drag racing, I sort of had a way to go. It was easy to get into, and you could sort of progress. So drag racing was where I got started actually racing.
From drag racing, Busby moved to sports cars, where he competed in the prestigious 24-hour race at Le Mans, France. And Le Mans is where Busby's heart lies.
Probably the 24 Hours of Le Mans is to me, the ultimate race. I know a lot of people in America would say that the Indy 500 is, but to me, personally, I think the 24 Hours of Le Mans is the ultimate race. I think it's the toughest, most grueling race that there is. And the fact that I've been able to go there three times and win my class twice and have my team win it the third time probably is the highest point of my career.
We're back inside the Busby Racing Porsche with driver Darren Brassfield at the wheel. And we'll be back with more IMSA Camel GT from Laguna Seca on ESPN right after these messages. Here at Laguna Seca, we took a look at the Busby Racing operation. That's Jim Busby, who just got into that car on the pit stop, replacing Darren Brassfield, but he's getting right back out, and they obviously have a serious problem, Bill.
With the engine cover being off, it's something more than just a regular stop, obviously, and they're looking at it fairly leisurely, so I don't expect to see them get back out.
Now, one more car out. Here is Curly Haywood running second at this point. The Jaguar putting on an excellent show today.
This car is running well.
Klaus Ludwig, your leader. He has led since the start of this race, putting another lap on the Camel Lights leader, the Pontiac Fiero.
And the viewers might note the front of the Jaguar looks a little...
Oh, no! John Paul Jr. in the Buick has spun. That's turn nine, leading out of the final straightaway. There are cars coming down the hill. This could be close.
Oh, geez, Johnny, be careful. Oh, and it looks...
Almost a replay of our last two accidents. John Paul Jr., here comes the Ford Probe number 07. That'll put Paul down into fourth place by our records.
Yep.
Bad break for John Paul Jr. in the Buick.
That sometimes is a problem with this turbocharger lag that I've referred to, because you have to anticipate. Now, here we've got the Jag coming into the pits as well. But because you anticipate where you want the horsepower, you have to actually put your foot on the floor before you really want full throttle. And I think maybe what happened with John is that he just got full throttle a fraction before he really wanted it.
Chip Robinson assisting Hurley Haywood out of the car. Robinson will get in. And here is your leader, Klaus Ludwig, up at the corkscrew, making his way around the track. This could be an opportunity for him to put... Whoa, and there's a service vehicle on the course. We'll have to check into that. Klaus Ludwig just getting by a service vehicle, making his way around. I'm surprised we didn't see any yellow flag there, Bill.
Not a thing. That's really quite...